ASB says the investigation could take up to 10 days. On Sunday, voters in Colombia are expected to approve a peace plan that ends a 52-year war with FARC rebels. The agreement calls for the rebels to hand over their weapons to the United Nations. In return, they're guaranteed seats in the Colombian Congress and are eligible for reduced punishment for crimes. Global News, 24 hours a day, powered by more than 2,600 journalists and analysts in over 120 countries. I'm Mark Crumpton in New York. Bloomberg West is next.
I'm Tom Giles, in for Emily Chang, and this is Bloomberg West. Coming up, are tech IPOs roaring back? We'll hear from the CEO of Nutanix as the company makes its trading debut and break down the stock's 130% first-day surge. Plus, Alphabet gets a loan sell rating on the street after Wedbush Securities downgrades the stock. We'll take a look at whether there's cause to be feeling bearish. And Intel dips its toe into the world of fitness wearables with a pair of smart sunglasses developed with Oakley. Will people wear them? We give them a try. But first to our lead, the first day of trading for Nutanix. Shares of the software company skyrocketed more than 130%, making it the best debut of the year. Tech IPOs have been few and far between this year. Remember, Nutanix had filed to go public in December of last year. Bloomberg's IPO reporter Alex Barranca sat down with CEO Dheeraj Pandey and asked him about the decision to list.
Ideally, it would have gone out in January, but the market was not ready. The oil crisis happened. And this was probably the first time that we could have it. We could have gone out in summers, but we said, look, the company is ripe, the scale is there. We want to really go deeper into the Global 2000. They want to see open books. And being public is one way of doing that.
So you priced above a share price range that you had increased in the course of the roadshow. The stock today is trading up. How are you feeling about how it's trading on your debut day?
You know, somewhat sanguine, because to me what matters is what happens in the next 6 months and 12 months and probably 18, 24 months. I'm just a long-term guy that way. It's like, you know, a baby was born and I'm not interested in the height and the weight, and more importantly, is the baby healthy?
And we have seen some of these offerings that preceded you, I'm talking the Twilios, the Acacias of the world, trade, you know, more than 200% higher than their listing price. Is there some kind of embedded concern about living up to your valuation post-IPO day?
You know, one thing I'm confident about is that the market in the short term is a voting machine, but in the long term is a weighing machine. So the substance of this company will come out in the longer term. You know, and what happens in the short term and how the voters vote based on the, you know, this news or that news and so on. You know, time actually takes care of that.
Speaking of substance of the company, you all were one of the early movers in this hyper-converged space. You saw sales increase more than 300% back in 2014, 90% in 2015, 84% in your last fiscal year. You know, what are you going to do to continue boosting that number? As, you know, we were hearing in the terms of the roadshow, investors were liking that growth.
Yeah, I think the key of all this is the character of the product, character of the customer service, repeat business from existing customers, because once we land, the whole goal is to expand, and you know, and that's where the depth of the relationship with the customer really comes. And when we have such deep with customers, partners like it as well. So just keep doing the basics right. It's like, you know, how do you stay healthy as the body? You go run, you avoid sugar, do all sorts of things like that. Definitely we are doing something highly differentiated, because it's hard to do what we do, you know, really building software and extracting all the value out of hardware and putting in pure software. But I think it's about going and charming them and having a net promoter score that we've talked about. You know, our customers love us for what we do.
Customers may love you, that might boost revenue, but these days investors have really wanted to see profitability. You haven't yet been profitable. You're still posting net losses. What are you working toward to get there? How long can investors expect that to take?
Yeah, so fiscal 16 that ended in July, we were operating cash flow positive. And there is a certain thing about billings and revenue that actually creates a delta for us because we defer enough for OEM business and such, and that only gets recognized over time. So in terms of operating profitability, it doesn't show today. But every year we're going and putting more guardrails so that we grow, but with enough guardrails in mind.
What do you mean by guardrails?
Guardrails like, you know, put some internal targets for free cash flow positive, and then put some internal guardrails for operating profitability and so on. I mean, we've not been a company that has just grown at all costs, you know, and you can see that from the past as well, and we hope to actually keep doing more of this going forward as well.
An impediment to growth has got to be competition. As we've talked about, you were one of the first in the space. We're seeing the biggest players, even the Ciscos of the world, kind of start to creep in. How do you continue to differentiate what you're doing so that you are continuing to gain customers?
Yeah, I mean, the key thing here is that Ciscos of the world don't have the full stack. When I say the full stack, it's the virtualization software, it's the storage software, it's the operations management software. All that is actually required to build what people are calling the enterprise cloud. So a lot of the hardware companies, they're actually saying we'll use some of VMware and put something in there and really go and build that. What we are saying is that, you know, you have to have the entire stack itself. So none of the server companies actually have that.
That was Nutanix CEO Dheeraj Pandey speaking with Bloomberg News IPO reporter Alex Barinka. Joining us now is David Blumberg, founder and managing partner of Bloomberg Capital. Bloomberg Capital has over a 5% stake in Nutanix and was one of the earliest investors of the in the company. Dave, thanks for joining us today.
Thanks,
so,
Tom.
Tell us about, you were there at the very earliest stage, big momentous day today, IPO. What did you see at the outset that made you think this is the right investment for us right now?
Sure. It's a classic Silicon Valley story. Three immigrants arrive from India, great strong backgrounds in computer sciences. They get great jobs at Google, Oracle, then Astra Data. And they came to us literally, no customers, no product, three guys in a business plan, no employees, but they had a vision. And they had a persistence and a steely look in their eye that said, we're going to achieve something really big. And what they outlined to us was a way of bringing web scale architecture that is using very smart software on top of commodity and increasingly lower cost hardware to the rest of the world. Google and Facebook and other great companies had pioneered this style of architecture, and Dheeraj and his colleagues, the co-founders, said to us, we want to bring that to everybody else. Small companies, nonprofits, governments, and large enterprises.
And they've held to that vision for the most part. We didn't see a lot of pivoting from the early days to now.
The nice point is that if you say pivot, it's more of a cornucopia. Their vision started and it's grown. They didn't shift and run around. They grew in a very, very nice progression.
We saw stock surge 130%. Great for those of you who are hanging on to the stock for now. Did the company leave too much money on the table? Are we being too conservative given the IPO environment right now?
I can't comment on the way stocks trade and so on and so forth. And the strategy was, you know, developed by their excellent investment banking team and the management and the board. But what I can say is that, you know, I'm a super happy shareholder, very proud of the way the team performed. And it's a testament to this great valley we live in, Silicon Valley, the American dream being realized over and over. You know, this company, it shows how fast companies can grow. They can sell in 80 countries in under 7 years, have thousands of customers, enterprise customers. It's kind of an astonishing story. So I think the difference between now and, say, 2000 era when companies went public is that companies today, and Nutanix exemplifies this really well, is real revenue, diverse set of customers, serious problem solving, hard technology.
Why now? There's been such an IPO drought, as we mentioned. What was the signal that now was the right time?
Again, I think that the December-November of 2015 saw a lot of turmoil in the markets. There were oil price crisis, there were down earnings numbers. And so the volatility of Wall Street has a negative impact sometimes down into our world of private companies. Nutanix saw that even though they were doing very well as a company, the market conditions weren't favorable. So they wisely held off. None of us pressured them. And I think it was a great call.
Talking about pressure, you know, how much are you hearing questions from your LPs? You know, we'd like to see some of these folks get out to market. We'd like to unlock a little bit of value. We'd like to realize some gains. How much of that is happening?
Well, the interesting thing in our case, and we've done it with another private company that's done very well, is that we were able to sell some stock in the secondary market about a year and a half ago. And that gave us some breathing room, and we could say to our investors, it's not just marked up on paper, we can actually return some capital to you. And so we more than covered our investment costs, and now all the rest of this is now gravy, and it's super exciting. I think our investors understand that venture capital is a long-term gain, and this holding cycle of about 7 years is probably about average to get to an IPO.
How much concern is there when you do a secondary? It's a bit risky, right? You don't want to send the signal of lost confidence. Some of these early investors looking to take a little money off the table. How do you strike that balance, and how do you avoid the appearance of losing confidence?
Right. Of course, we did it in conjunction with and clearing it with the founders and management before we did so. And it was a small portion of our holding. And I think it's very important that people understand Sarbanes-Oxley and other regulatory matters have changed the way Wall Street works. It's made it much harder to go public. So many companies have to stay private longer. Now, their cash flow needs for the founders. They want to buy a house here in the Bay Area, pretty pricey. So some of them sold as well. Not huge amounts, but enough to get by. And we returned enough to make our LPs quite happy.
In the last couple seconds, outlook for IPOs in 2017, especially given the uncertainty around the election and certain things in the economy?
Here's the thing. The technology world seems to be more of a constant than a variable. It is growing. We are seeing incredible disruptive power by these newcomers. And big companies are starting to say, we need to buy from startups rather than only the legacies. So I think tech innovation is more of a standard than a variable. It's here to stay.
Thanks so much for being with us today.
My pleasure, Tom.
David Bloomberg, managing partner and founder of Bloomberg Capital. Thanks again. Coming up, Wedbush Securities downgrades Alphabet, giving the stock its only sell rating on the street. We'll speak to analyst James Dix about why he's feeling bearish. And speaking of Alphabet, tech giants are dominating the S&P's rally with strength not seen since the bull market started in 2009. A gauge for the industry rallied 12% since the end of June, four times more than the next best group. More of Bloomberg West coming up next. This is Bloomberg. Turning now to Alphabet, which just got its first analyst downgrade to underperform. It's the only sell rating out there for the stock. Wedbush analyst James Dick says Google's search ad business could come under pressure as mobile technology helps marketers go directly to consumers. He joins us now to discuss this in more detail, along with Bloomberg News reporter Mark Bergen.
Hey, Tom.
Yeah, all right. James, thanks so much for being with us today. Well, tell us a little bit about why you have taken this somewhat bold bet and downgraded Alphabet.
It basically has to do with three, I guess, primarily technology trends, which could lead to what I see as potential risk to the business model of paid search. So the first trend has been, I think, over the past year, a more rapid shift in monetization of paid search, especially on mobile, through addition of ads and changing the mix of the traffic to being more paid traffic as opposed to organic traffic. So to some extent, the business becomes more of like an advertising engine as opposed to a search engine merely supported by advertising. And, you know, one potential risk there is that, you know, that reduces the moat between that type of experience and other advertising engines, which might be better for advertisers and consumers. The other trend, the second trend, which I think has been moving faster than expected, is the consumer's ability to control IP-delivered ads. Probably the most specific example of that would be the rise of ad blocking, which a year or two ago was not expected to be, it was not that substantial. Now in many markets, depending on the data that you look at, it could be a quarter of the user base has installed some form of ad blocking. This allows consumers and sensitizes them to taking control of their ad experience and potentially controlling the ads that they're exposed to. And then the last trend is the rapid acceleration in payments platforms. And what that potentially allows is the connection between digitally between your exposure to an ad, whether you shop for a product, and then whether you paid for the product and purchased for the product, and therefore allowing people to potentially pay directly to consumers to engage with ads, regardless of whether they actually buy from that particular advertiser, but simply whether they buy at all. And that's what I call like paid attention or attention markets. And so that's the risk to paid search's business model.
And James, I mean, Alphabet's been very aggressive about moving into other markets, trying out new things. They're taking some things off the table. Aren't you at all optimistic about their move into some of these other businesses?
Oh, I think some of the moves that they've made to more focus their strategy, they give more clarity as to where they're investing in terms of other bets, some of their longer term, initiatives versus some of their core businesses have been the right things to do. The fact remains that paid search remains far and away the most important driver of the actual financial results of the company that investors depend on. It continues to be a company which is 90% advertising revenue, and the most profitable part of that advertising revenue base is paid search. I do not see their current initiatives changing that dramatically over the next couple of years.
I'd like to bring my colleague Mark Bergen into the conversation. Mark, this is his first appearance on Bloomberg West, and you're just now starting to cover Google for us here at Bloomberg. Talk a little bit about, speaking of new products, next week, we're going to see Google announcing some new hardware things. Tell us a little bit about what you know coming down the pike.
Yeah, next week is every fall, Google puts out their Nexus launch, which has been historically their kind of reference design for Android devices. And they're showing Android phone makers, this is what we want a phone to look like. And it's important for Google as they're competing with Apple. And there's been a lot of pressure on the high end. A lot of the Android device makers have struggled recently. Google certainly felt that. And Android is a really key strategy to their mobile advertising. What James pointed out, a lot of their future and their search business is really dependent on having a really strong presence on Android.
And yesterday, we heard more from Diane Greene about their cloud initiative. Tell us a little bit about your expectations for what Diane Greene is doing and whether they really have a chance against Azure, against Amazon, some of these other players.
Yeah, yesterday was sort of the culmination of Diane. She came on in November, last November. It's been almost a year. Her first goal was to sort of bring united fronts to the sales team because they had all these disparate, you know, there's the apps for work, it's like Google Apps and then Google Cloud, just putting them all under one roof and uniting the sales team. It's taken a long time. There's the sense inside the company that, you know, historically it's been in engineering, it's been in a consumer product company, it's never really been an enterprise company. She's kind of fighting an uphill battle there, and she's also in the market, and Amazon and Microsoft are well ahead.
Wedbush Securities analyst James Dix and Bloomberg's Mark Bergen, thank you both for joining us. Coming up, looks like Qualcomm is ready to make a major acquisition. But is NXP the right fit for the chip giant? We'll bring you the latest next. This is Bloomberg. Qualcomm finally looks ready to make a big deal, with Bloomberg confirming that Qualcomm has held early talks with several potential targets, including NXP Semiconductors. The goal? San Diego-based company wants to shore up key markets in a rapidly consolidating industry. Joining me now to discuss is Bloomberg's Ian King. Ian, thanks for being with us today. All right, so what's Qualcomm out there looking for?
Several options, as far as we understand. The driving force behind this, though, is do they want to make a transformational decision? Do they want to go and use that $30 billion that they've got? Or do they want to stay the course with what they've been doing up until now, which is incremental? We need this technology. We need that technology. We'll spend a bit here and there to bring those in. So that's our understanding of what's going on in their thought process right now.
What does NXP do for Qualcomm?
NXP is route one, basically, into automotive silicon. Qualcomm is already trying to do that with some of its mobile phone chips. NXP is a lot stronger in that, has a lot broader portfolio, and it just bought Freescale last year, so it's pretty much the biggest maker of chips for cars.
Where's the pressure coming from? Is this about the rising costs of making the chips? Where is this coming from?
That's a good question. I mean, there's a lot of pressure from a lot of sides. On the one hand, they have that huge chunk of cash. Shell does want them to do something with it. They don't want it just sat there overseas. The other hand, it's a classic case that we've seen for many companies. Very good at one market, make a brilliant living in that market, in this case, the smartphones. Then things slow down, competition comes along, profitability gets squeezed, revenue growth gets squeezed. What do you do next? Do you take that money that you've gained in that one thing you're good at and make a big bet? Or do you stay the course and hope that the market recovers?
So we broke some news today at Bloomberg about there being multiple potential targets.
Yeah.
Now, something about NXP that makes it attractive is its overseas location.
Yeah.
How much of the tax and the burden of tax plays into why Qualcomm might be looking at NXP in particular.
I mean, a very good point, and that's a general point for a lot of semiconductor makers and tech companies in general. They have a lot of cash overseas. In Qualcomm's case, $17 billion or so in cash that they've never brought back. They've just parked it overseas because they don't want to pay U.S. taxes, double taxes. So if you can effectively use that cash to produce, to buy something that then brings you revenue, then obviously that's an effective use. However, if there's a tax holiday, if there's something going on with the U.S. tax codes, then maybe you think about that, maybe you reconsider that.
And we've just broken some news crossing the wire just now saying that NXP is working with Catalyst to explore a sale. What does that mean about NXP and its position here?
Yeah, I mean, I'm glad that just happened while we were talking. Obviously, we've been working on that today. This is basically confirming that NXP is a potential seller. They have somebody in place to deal with incomings, whether it's from Qualcomm, whether it's from somebody else. We understand that they've spoken to several potential bidders, at least reached out and said, are you interested?
Bloomberg's Ian King, thank you. And Ian will be joining us a little later in the show to take a look at how Intel has teamed up with Oakley to make sunglasses that talk to you. Up next, we'll focus on trends shaping venture capital funding today with NEA's head of tech investing, Scott Sandell. This is Bloomberg.
I'm Mark Crumpton. You're watching Bloomberg West. Let's begin with a check of your first word news. The United States is considering sanctions against Russia over Syria. State Department spokesman Mark Toner says Moscow still hasn't taken steps to end the violence in Aleppo.
We have not definitively closed that door. We have not definitively suspended our diplomatic relations regarding Syria with Russia. We're on the verge because we have not yet seen them take the kind of actions that we're looking to see them take.
Russia says that for any credible ceasefire to begin, Washington should separate the moderate opposition from al-Qaeda's branch in Syria. President Obama joined dignitaries from around the world at funeral services in Jerusalem for former Israeli Prime Minister Shimon Peres, who died this week at the age of 93. The president called on the next generation of leaders to complete Peres's vision of peace between Israelis and Palestinians. Peres was buried next to another Israeli Prime Minister, Yitzhak Rabin, who was assassinated in 1995. The Commission on Presidential Debate says there were problems with Donald Trump's audio during the first debate. According to a statement on its website, the commission wrote, quote, "There were issues with Donald Trump's audio that affected the sound level in the debate hall," end quote. Trump had said on Monday night that his microphone was faulty. A Homeland Security Department official tells the Associated Press hackers have targeted the voter registration systems of more than 20 states in recent months. The FBI last month warned state officials to improve their election security after hackers targeted systems in Illinois and Arizona. U.S. officials say election systems are generally not connected to the Internet, making it harder for hackers to alter election outcomes. Pope Francis has received a warm welcome from the leader of the Georgian Orthodox Church, who called him a dear brother and Your Holiness. Relations between the church and the Vatican have been strained. Back in 1999, tensions were so high that the Georgian Orthodox Church urged its faithful to stay away from a mass by Pope John Paul II. Francis issued a vague rebuke to Russia Friday, insisting the former Soviet Republic had, in the pontiff's words, sovereign rights. Italian police have found two Van Gogh paintings that were stolen from an Amsterdam museum in 2002. They were hidden in a farmhouse near an organized crime syndicate stronghold in Naples. The officials are, quote, in relatively good condition. Italy's interior minister said the paintings were, again quoting, considered the among the artworks most searched for in the world on the FBI's list of top 10 art crimes. Global News 24 hours a day, powered by more than 2,600 journalists around the world. I'm Mark Crumpton. This is Bloomberg.
This is Bloomberg West. I'm Tom Giles in for Emily Chang. Nutanix shares surged in their trading debut Friday after the software maker raised more than $230 million in an expanded IPO. It joins a handful of other smaller tech IPOs in recent weeks, from Trade Desk, Apptio, and Everbridge. But that being said, 2016 has been the slowest year for U.S. tech IPOs in 7 years. Joining us now to put the funding environment into perspective is NEA's head of tech investing, Scott Sandell. Scott, thanks for being with us today.
Thanks for having me, Tom.
Well, it's a big day. Nutanix, huge surge. Talk about whether this is going to open the floodgates for tech IPOs.
You know, it's a great day for tech IPOs, obviously, and maybe not by itself, but I think it's the beginning, because these things always come in cycles. And in the beginning of a good cycle, you have to have something that's encouraging to other investors. And the way that happens is that the first, you know, penguins that jump off the iceberg into the cold water offer something really attractive, and they offer it at an attractive price. That's, of course, why this share surged 131% today. We saw Twilio a couple of weeks ago, also a really nice outcome. So now all those investors on Wall Street are starting to think, maybe this is a good time to get back into IPOs. And pretty soon, after four or five more of these nice things, they're going to decide they can't afford to live without them.
You've been through this many times before. Do you think we're going to get to a situation where the founders, their advisors, seeing these big stock surges, and they're going to start saying, okay, well, we're leaving a little bit too much money on the table. We should probably be a little bit bolder, a little bit more aggressive.
Well, you know, it's interesting. People often think that it's the venture capitalists or the founders who want to take their companies public. That actually turns out not, in my experience, to be the primary driver for companies that don't need to go public. So a lot of the companies that are sort of ready to go public today, and I think there's a terrific backlog, don't need to go public because in the recent couple of years, they could raise significant amounts of capital both to fund their business and to provide liquidity for, you know, founders and some early investors. So that's not the reason they want to go public today, but what ultimately happens is the employees want to go public. And they also find value in the credibility of being a public company for the benefit of their big enterprise customers.
How much are LPs, though, playing a role in this? They've seen this drought. They're concerned about returns. They're, yes, we're in this for the long haul, but it's been a really, really long haul given that so many companies are staying private for so much longer.
You know, I think it depends. Probably for some firms, that's a big issue. It's not a huge issue for us, but we're mindful of it. You know, our LPs have been patient with us for long periods of time, and they want to get a return, and so we'll give it to them. But we don't do that in a way that puts, you know, the companies at risk. You have to put the company's interests first, and if you do that, it generally works out well.
So given that we're probably, it sounds like you're pretty optimistic about the outlook for IPOs going forward, do you think we'll see fewer of these kind of secondary sales, these transactions that are aimed at kind of unlocking liquidity, getting employees a little bit more money, like we were talking about earlier? The CEO wants to buy a house in Menlo Park, et cetera.
I actually think that's going to continue, but it's going to continue for companies at earlier stages of their development. And it's going to continue because it's actually worked pretty well in this cycle, meaning that, you know, this early liquidity has enabled companies to be patient and stay private longer, which is where innovation happens. Once you become public, it's hard to continue making those aggressive bets, which are sometimes needed to build a really big company.
We're talking about kind of the outlook going into 2017. There's a lot to be bullish about, today's performance among them. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, there's also some potential negative catalysts. There's war overseas, there's the election. What kind of role do you see that playing, and how might that kind of change the thesis?
Well, there are probably some firms that'll go public between now and the election who wanted to get out before the election for exactly that reason. But it's too late, and you know, it's too close to the election to make that decision today. So that would have had to been made, you know, a few months back. Anybody, you know, it's anybody's guess what the election will do. But I think the stock market seems to be behaving pretty well in spite of the election coming up, and we know who the candidates are. So, and we don't know what the outcome's going to be, and the stock market's still happy. So that tells me that's probably not a huge factor.
Based on what you know about where the candidates stand on the issues that are important to startups and venture capital firms, is there one that you think would be better for the world that you operate in?
Well, I mean, I of course have my personal preference. NEA doesn't make, you know, political statements. Since I'm one of the managing partners, I'd probably refrain from telling you what my personal vote would be.
But in terms of just looking kind of objectively at the scene, can you talk a little bit about what you think might be a more optimal outcome?
I personally think that it sort of depends on your view of who will manage the economy better, which is more of a personal reflection. Though Donald Trump is a businessman, I actually think Hillary would do a better job with the economy. And I think there's a consensus, so it's not just a personal opinion. There have been some recent surveys of CEOs and things like that, which have very heavily drawn that conclusion.
We've talked about, you know, despite the bullishness in the market right now, there's certainly some non-VC actors that really plowed a lot of money into the market, particularly in 2015, mm-hmm. who've kind of refrained, held back a little bit. How is that changing the investing environment? What does that mean, particularly for late-stage investors?
Well, clearly the market's pulled back, and because those actors are no longer present in the marketplace, things have slowed down. But there's a lot of capital in the system. You have to remember the venture industry has raised record or nearly record amounts of capital for the last couple of years. So what it really boils down to is the good companies can get funded, and they can get funded from high-quality sources, which is what you want to see. What you don't want to see is when there's too much capital, things get funded that shouldn't get funded. And that's ultimately destructive to returns.
I'd love to hear your thoughts on a couple of NEA portfolio companies, MuleSoft, Cloudflare. Those are a couple companies we've been keeping our eye on. Is 2017 the year they take the plunge?
Well, I'm not allowed to say that, Tom, but I can tell you, and these two companies are located just nearby, they're both doing spectacularly well. Both could be public companies at any time, and it'll be up to the board to decide when the time is right for them.
Couple of the technologies that you are most excited about, where you are looking and your partners are looking at for where to invest down the road?
Well, as you know, we have a very broad investment mandate across all of information technology, healthcare. One of the things I'm most excited about is that the technology platform created online and by the cloud is enabling people to start businesses outside of technology. We now have, by last count, 36 separate industries where we've funded companies. Think of something like Casper in the mattress industry. Who would have thought of funding a mattress company? It's doing spectacularly well. You know, Metromile is changing, you know, the landscape for auto insurance. CareZone is changing it for online pharmaceutical delivery. There's things happening everywhere you look.
Scott Sandell, head of tech investing at NEA, thank you for joining us. On today's funding board, China's two largest bike sharing services have both landed major investments within days of each other. Beijing's Ofo raised $100 million in a round, valuing the company at $500 million. That's according to people familiar with the private deals. And its rival, Mobike, separately raised $100 million from Hill House Capital, among other investors. Coming up, the average age of a U.S. worker is 42, but in Silicon Valley, it's closer to 31. We'll discuss the tech industry's age bias next. And don't forget to tune in this weekend. We'll bring you all our best interviews from the week, including entrepreneur and investor Reid Hoffman. His thoughts on where Silicon Valley stands on the 2016 presidential race. That's on Saturday. This is Bloomberg. Lorene Powell Jobs, the widow of Apple co-founder Steve Jobs, has taken a minority stake in the film company Anonymous Content. That's the production house behind Oscar-winning films such as Spotlight and The Revenant. Jobs' investment comes through her fund Emerson Collective, and it'll help Anonymous produce more socially conscious films. VCs in Silicon Valley have a term for the ideal job candidate, a blue flame. That means a young person in their 20s with lots of energy and no kids. This is just one example of how Silicon Valley is becoming increasingly young. While the average U.S. worker is 42, in Silicon Valley that number is more likely to be 31. Joining me now to discuss the age bias in the tech industry is AtScale CEO David Mariani. David, thank you so much for being with us.
Hi, Tom.
Why has it gotten to this point? Why is Silicon Valley worse than other industries?
Well, you know, like when it comes to investment and venture capital, I think there's been an overemphasis on youth as opposed to age. So, and if you look at pattern matching, which is what these good VCs are excellent at, they tend to follow each other, and they end up investing in a lot of young startups with first-time CEOs who are swinging for the fences.
The idea is that maybe young people are more likely to take bigger risks. Is that it? And if you're married, if you've got kids, you're thinking about college, you're thinking about your second house in the Hamptons, or that you're less likely to kind of tuck in for the long haul and wait for a payoff down the road. Is that the idea?
Yeah, that's a big part of it, because they're looking for home runs. They're looking for billion-dollar outcomes. And I remember, very prominent VC in the Valley spent 2 hours in a room with two partners, and the questions are asking me about what's your goal? Is your goal for to buy a yacht or an island? And it's like, that's not my goal at all. My goal is to build a big business and really solve the problem that I've been suffering with, as a customer, for the past 10 years. And so it's very frustrating, because I see companies who would get funded, building a product that really was not a product that I would buy, but because they're young and because of that energy and that bias, they're the ones who get funded.
So employees are doing some really interesting things to kind of get around this bias, to sort of mask themselves, if you will. Mm-hmm. Can you talk to us a little bit about what employees are doing?
Look, ultimately, I think that people recognize experience. And look, in any company, you got to have the right balance. You got to have youth brings energy. It brings new ideas, willing to take risks. And seasoning, I like to call it seasoning, brings experience and its own set of pattern matching. And it also makes it much easier to hire and build teams, because you've actually worked with people. You know the people that you work with, who's good and who's not, and you can bring them along in your venture. So to me, I like to think that you have to be able to sell to a company that is a company that you likely have worked for, or at least in the industry. You've got to be able to use the products and have used the products that you're trying to sell into. So it's really hard to do that if this is your first job.
And, do you see this spreading outside of Silicon Valley? Because as more industries try to be like the tech industry, they want to be lean, they want to be innovative, do you see them kind of adopting some of these same strategies? And what's the risk?
Well, when you hire people, you hire people like yourself. So if companies are being funded with young management teams, they're going to hire other young people and sort of perpetuate that bias. So ultimately, I think it's something that's very specific to Silicon Valley. I don't necessarily think that you'll see that outside. You'll see some of the excesses of like focus on catered lunches and dry cleaning and massages, things that absolutely don't help customers at all, but are things that highly funded types of startup companies will sort of indulge in because they think that it's competitive.
And in the last few seconds, what are things that employers could and should be thinking about to avoid some of these age biases?
Well, it's about the right blend. So you want to bring in young people into the organization, especially in newer positions, so they can grow and they can challenge you and bring in other ideas. But you can't really substitute for experience. That is so important to be able to have lived and failed, and know not to repeat those mistakes.
Dave, thank you so much for being with us today.
Thanks,
Dave Mariani, AtScale CEO. Headlines that we're watching just now. Google is said to be working with Lazard to consider a bid for Twitter. It's not clear whether Google will actually formally make a bid, but we're watching for developments and we'll bring you the latest as we get it. Coming up, sunglass maker Oakley and Intel have paired up to change the way you work out. We'll give you the details next. This is Bloomberg. Oakley wants to change the way you work out. The sunglass maker has collaborated with Intel to announce the Radar Pace, a new sports-focused eyewear. The specs boast features like a voice-activated coaching system and built-in headphones. Joining now to discuss is Intel Senior Director of Business Development, Chris Croteau, and Bloomberg reporter Ian King is back with us. Chris, Ian, thanks for being with us.
Thanks, Tom.
All right, what do these spectacles do besides make Ian King here look amazing?
Doesn't he look awesome? These are the first eyewear that has an active coaching system built in. So we set out when Intel partnered with Luxottica to find real problems that we could solve for their consumers. Part of our wearable strategy was to work with lifestyle and consumer companies and build wearable products that actually solved a need. What we found was runners and cyclists needed help. They needed help to achieve their best performance, and that's what Radar Pace does.
So what kinds of things will I be hearing in my ear? When I'm running, I want to hear music. I don't want to hear outside stuff.
So totally streams music. Any music you've got playing on your phone will play in these glasses. But coupled with that is a coach that analyzes your performance to a goal. And that's the real thing here, is you set a goal. Whether you want to do free-form running just to get stronger or have more endurance, or you want to run your first marathon. You set that goal, this tracks your performance before, during, and after your workout. And what you'll hear is statistics that are important to you. Things like your speed, your stride rate, your heart rate, whether you're pushing too much, not enough, just to keep you in those workout zones to make you the best athlete possible.
And what else do I have to have hooked up? Do I have to have something, some monitor somewhere, something on my wrist?
You don't have to have anything but your phone with you for Radar Pace to help you. But anything that you already have seamlessly integrates through Bluetooth Low Energy or Ant Plus.
Ian, you've tried them out. How do they work?
Well, obviously, in the 2 days that I've been trying them, I've turned into a world-class athlete. Isn't that evident? If I'm honest, in terms of setting them up, in terms of using them, you have to put the work in to get, to have it working as effectively as you would hope. In terms of the technology, voice recognition, as we know, is really difficult, and the slightest bit of wind, the slightest bit of background noise, and it tends to fall apart. These, surprisingly good, I have to say.
Now, you're working with Intel. Ian, you're our Intel chip reporter.
Yeah.
Tell us about kind of what the technology behind it a little bit, and how does it fit into Intel's strategy?
Well, I don't want to speak on behalf of Intel, but, the CEO, Brian Krzanich, is out there. He's pushing all manner of gadgets, and his push is, look, Intel's famous for PCs. But that's where we've made our living. Very good at servers. That's where we made it very profitable. But in the future, everything's going to be connected, everything's going to be computed, we need to be in it. So he's pushing lots of projects like this to try and, spread the use of Intel's chips and broaden their, their base of sales.
What is the kind of the market opportunity here that we're talking about, this combination of eyewear with more advanced technology?
Well, the eyewear is just one small component of our wearable strategy that, depending on which analyst you look at, is multiple billions of units in the next decade. Really, as Ian talks about, what we started to set out to do was to build experiences, not just build a product or build a chip, but literally an end-to-end experience. And so if you look at where Intel's going with our virtuous cycle, everything's connected. It's from the device to your phone to the connectivity to the cloud. And this really pulls it all together, but in a way that's seamless for users.
And these go on sale or have been on sale?
These are on sale October 1st at Oakley stores and online.
And do you have any projections in terms of the number of units?
We're anticipating gangbuster sales based on the initial feedback and folks like Ian.
We'll see how that works out. Well, thank you so much for being with us today. Intel Senior Director of Business Development, Chris Croteau, and Bloomberg's Ian King, thank you for joining us. That does it for this edition of Bloomberg West. On Monday, do not miss our conversation with former Twitter CEO Dick Costolo. This after Bloomberg reported this hour that Google is working with Lazard to consider a bid for Twitter. We'll keep you up to speed with all the latest developments. That's all for now from Bloomberg San Francisco. This is Bloomberg.
studios in New York City. This